important time for leadership. You have the Russia investigation. You have what just happened in Las Vegas and a larger conversation about how do we stop this from happening again. So on Russia, the Senate Intel Committee is saying that there's still a lot of work to do on the issue of collusion between Russia and the Trump campaign, that it's a still open part of their investigation. This comes as CNN has learned Russian-linked ads bought on Facebook targeted a wide range of states, but included two key swing states, Michigan and Wisconsin. Joining us now is Congressman Adam Schiff of California. He is the ranking Democrat on the House Intel Committee. Congressman, always a pleasure. Thank you for taking the opportunity.
Pleasure.
So they targeted Wisconsin and Michigan. People who followed the election, their eyes pop open. How did they know? Did they need to have help to target places like that?
This is the critical question, and I have to say at this point, we still don't know the answer. Is this something that merely sophisticated watchers of TV, either here or from the Kremlin, could figure out, or did they need the data analytics of the campaign? That will depend on just how in detail was the targeting. Did it go beyond battle states, which, you know, are widely known? I have to say also that a lot of what they did is very consistent with the intelligence community assessment in that they had two goals. They wanted to sow discord in the United States. They wanted to turn American against another American. So you saw ads in places like Ferguson, and you saw ads around Freddie Gray in Baltimore. Obviously, you know, those were less designed to tip the election one way or the other. But you had others that seemed to be targeted. And I will say that a lot less attention is paid to the ads on Twitter. RT, the Russia propaganda arm, advertised on Twitter. Now, almost the entire set of ads that I've seen, and I'm told it's a representative sample, those were all anti-Clinton ads. So on that platform, there was a very clear choice.
All right, so two quick follows. The first one is, what do you do about it? How do you stop? How do you filter? How do you monitor political ads in a way that doesn't chill free speech and that allows a private entity to do that? Because you guys aren't going to be able to do it on the government level. This is Twitter, this is Facebook, this is social media entrepreneurs.
You know, we're going to have a much stronger partnership where when the intelligence community identifies troll farms, Russian troll farms, like the one here, they share that information with the social media companies so they can identify those accounts and they can take them down. But also the social media companies are going to have to do a far better job. They're going to have to devote more resources and personnel. They're going to have to take another look at their algorithms to see, are these just aggravating divisions within U.S. society?
Not how they make their money. They make their money
That's
by inclusion.
True. That's true. So some of this is going to be against their economic interests, but they're going to have to be good corporate citizens, and we in Congress are going to have to do our oversight to make sure their policies are in the public interest. But, you know, one subset of this is going to be very tough, and you know, that's involving RT, this Russia media arm. Are they a journalistic organization, or are they just propaganda for the Kremlin? Well, they're both. They are a Kremlin-funded effort to get the Russian point of view out. But at a minimum, we need disclosure. You need to know, I think, whether it's me buying an ad or the Russians, they ought to have a disclosure online, just as we do when people advertise on your show.
Right. I mean, the money part's easy. I know that Klobuchar and Warner, two Democratic senators, have put forth a proposal that if you buy an ad over 10 grand, we should know who you are. You certainly do that on the TV side, ad buys. Why wouldn't you do it on the digital side? That's one decision. But the subjective decision, whether it's RT or something less obvious, that's going to get tough. It's going to get subjective, and you're going to have private people who, with Twitter and Facebook, we've seen, they knew about these accounts before you guys start banging on their door. They didn't come forward. Why? I'm not implicating them in the efforts, but their business interest is in inclusion, not being selective in exclusion. Let me ask you another question. With more time, the basic criticism looms larger. You haven't found anything yet. There is no proof of collusion. There's nothing anybody can point to. This has taken too long. If it was so obvious, if it were so egregious, you should have known by now.
Well, no one is saying that this was obvious, and obviously there was a deep interest in the Russians in keeping their work hidden. But you can't say there's no evidence of collusion. We've seen even in the public realm, I think, very graphic evidence that the Trump campaign was willing to collude with the Russians. We have seen emails in black and white from the top level of the Trump campaign, indeed the president's own son, when he is offered dirt on Hillary Clinton by the Russians as what they described as the Russian government's effort to help elect Donald Trump. He says, we'd love it. And by the way, the best timing is late summer, which is, in fact, when they started dumping the dirt on Hillary Clinton. So you can't say even in the public realm, let alone what we're looking at, that there's no evidence. Now, is there proof beyond a reasonable doubt? Are we ready to announce a conclusion? We're not there yet.
That's also not your purview, right? I mean, that's a criminal standard. That's Mueller. You guys would be looking at political action. I guess you'd put that under the category of high crimes and misdemeanors, which is not a legal standard. Collusion is not a legal principle. But you're right. Ultimately, it comes out to what you can prove. So we look forward to that because everybody wants this to yield something that can be discussed, accounted for, and then acted upon. Other topic, all right? Russia trying to destroy our political society. This man in Vegas trying to destroy us every bit as much. The president, the Republicans say it's insensitive to talk about gun control now, that that's politicizing the event. There are many in this society, including many of the people who were victimized, who do not agree. What is your position in terms of what could be done that would have stopped this crime?
Well, and interestingly, tragically, there's an overlap in the issues in that one of the things the Russians have chosen to exploit of our divisions are our divisions over the Second Amendment, over guns. Those were some of the ads that they targeted. Well, look, we had this debate, frankly, in my office. We were planning to introduce a bill, which we're going to go ahead and introduce this week, that would essentially repeal the gun industry's immunity from liability. The gun industry is unique in all of American commerce. It's the only industry that has a statute, a congressionally created immunity that says they're not liable in circumstances where every other product, every other industry might be.
Was that fair, or is it that, well, okay, the last part you said. If they are negligent, because the counter argument is they would be the only industry that you're allowed to sue when their weapons didn't malfunction. If there was no problem in terms of their product, you just don't like how it was used, and when you want to sue the person who made it, that would be unique exposure as well.
They're not unique at all in the sense that, look, let's take alcohol, for example. It's perfectly legal to sell alcohol. It is not legal to be negligent in who you sell it to and to turn a blind eye when kids come in to buy alcohol in your store. That is not permissible. That is not legal.
That's the store. That's not Jack Daniels.
No, that's right. Now, Jack Daniels is selling to a store they know is basically selling to kids. We don't want to immunize the manufacturer when they know a dealer that they're dealing with.
If you can show that.
You have to show that. And okay. You should be able to have to show that with the gun industry, too. But they don't get a pass to act negligently. And now, in answer to your question, though, we thought, well, maybe we should hold off this week in introducing this. But if we held off every week where there's a shooting, we would never introduce gun legislation. These topics shouldn't be any more taboo, frankly, than they are when a terrorist attack occurs and we ask, what do we do to stop terrorism? There are people dying every day from gun violence. We need to deal with it. And there's a fallacy that if one particular bill won't stop one particular incident, well, then there's no point in having any gun legislation because there's no cure-all. But the fact is that there are several things that would stop a lot of these attacks or make them less lethal. Background checks will prevent some and have prevented many from getting guns that don't deserve to have them or will be a danger with them. Getting rid of the bump stocks would prevent, maybe not prevent the shooting, make a hell of a lot less lethal.
Certainly in this case, very often they say, well, law wouldn't have fixed what happened here. That's sometimes true. Not here in terms of the lethality. The only reason that we're listening to this unique hail of gunfire is because of that bump stock. He wouldn't have been able to generate that kind of speed otherwise. Congressman, we look forward to your proposition on how to help situations like what we just saw in Vegas be less likely, and we'll be following the Russia investigation as well. Thank you for taking the opportunity to be on the show.
Thank you.